Hi, everyone. Welcome back to Wall Street Silver. We have a very special guest joining us today, Ed Steer, the author of Ed Steer's Gold and Silver Digest. Ed, it's great to see you again.
Well, it's good to be back on your show, and congratulations to you and all your apes out there. It's just going fantastic for you guys.
Well, I hear you're on Wall Street Silver's Reddit page all the time, Ed, so you're one of them. All right. Yeah. I mean, if you're on it 20 times, if you're on the website 20 times a day, you're one of them.
So, I'm proud to be so as well.
Yeah. Hey, so it's been an exciting week. Silver is, raging higher. I've got the chart up on the screen. So I'm sure it must be an exciting week for you. And what are your thoughts on this? Is this a temporary rally or is this something significant?
Well, this rally has been overdue for a very long time from a commitment of traders standpoint. Ted has said that, we've been sitting on the launch pad for a price blowout in all the precious metals, silver and gold, both together. And we finally got, gold's above its 200-day, and finally silver took off in the last 3 days. And there's no question, it's very exciting to watch. And we're all hoping for the best. My concern is, if you take a look back at the middle of November, silver had another big blowout rally. And the big four shorts who control the price stopped it cold right at its 200-day moving average. Now we're right back there again as of the close today. We'll see what transpires in the next couple of days because, we have to have a major breakout above the 200-day moving average before we're going to see some real serious money in here. But there's no question, it's good to see there's money, there's silver going into all the ETFs now. I was checking it yesterday, and if you read my column this morning, there was 880,000 ounces deposited into SIVR. And, that's just going to continue, and where they're going to get the silver from, because as everybody and his dog out there knows, I mean, the physical market is tight both on a retail level and on a wholesale level. So once this thing develops some legs, I mean, it's going to be Katie bar the door from a price and a physical point of view, because silver just isn't there.
Well, what do you think's important here? I don't know. Do you care about the technicals, or are you watching the 200-day moving average, or do we need to get above this previous November high?
The technicals mean nothing in a managed market, and silver and gold have been managed for 30 or 40 years. Mm-hmm. But there are lots of people out there, the technicians that trade specifically on the 50-day and 100-day and 200-day moving averages. So you have to acknowledge the fact that there are people out there that trade this way. And so when I look at the chart, I know perfectly well the underlying fundamentals from a physical standpoint are roaring bull market, but you have to also acknowledge the fact that there are four traders out there that are going to decide whether the price is going to break out or not. So yes, it's very important to look at the technicals, but from a physical supply standpoint, the price should be many, many multiples of what it is now. So yes, mm-hmm. Technicals are important, and that's why I'm watching them.
Well, so the four traders that are really controlling this, everyone's been talking lately about Bank of America and their position on that. And I know you've been all over that issue a lot. Ted Butler, obviously, to his credit, he's the one who first wrote about this that everyone read about. What's your take on all that? I mean, the Bank of America 800 million ounce short position.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, everything important in the silver market, because Ted's been doing this for almost 40 years now. Anything important about the silver market's been through him first. And of course, this blowout short position by Bank of America in silver was something that caught me completely by surprise. And there's no question about it. I look at the OCC's latest report, and it's right there in black and white that they're short the white metals to that amount. And of course, the white metals also include platinum and palladium, but they're dinky markets compared to silver. And it's as real as rain that Bank of America is on the short hook for 800 million ounces of silver that they have to repay to friends of JP Morgan who leased it to them. And sooner or later, that chicken is going to come home to roost along with the short positions in the COMEX futures market. That's a setup for a rally of biblical proportions in silver is only exacerbated by the fact that BOA went on the short side. And man, it's going to be interesting to see how this resolves itself. It's very exciting times.
You know, there's been some funny memes about that on Wall Street Silver on the Reddit community. Someone drove up to a Bank of America branch with some of their silver and said, "So close, yet so far away for them."
I saw that today. It's, you know, I'll tell you what, the people on the Wall Street Silver crowd are just, it's phenomenal to watch these guys. It's just amazing to watch the psychology of the group as it matures since you guys first showed up on the scene last March. It's amazing to watch. And then stuff like this, just rubbing salt into an open wound. And you said I go into Wall Street Silver 20 times a day. I hate to admit it's probably more than that. I have the tab open on my computer all the time.
I'm glad we have Reddit to do this for us. It makes tweeting a lot easier for me. I just take funny stuff off of Reddit and put it on Twitter.
Ed, if the stock market continues to go negative, do you think more people will continue to push to precious metals?
Oh, well, yeah, that's pretty much a given, because not only will the stock market be heading south, but you're going to see the bond market spike higher the interest rates spike higher, and the flight from paper assets, whether they be stocks or bonds, will become an absolute flood. And there's only two places you can put your money, either in cash or you can go into the precious metals. And we've seen in the past, last year, when January, I think it was, when the price ran up to $30 or so, the amount of silver was being pouring into the, and gold that was pouring into the ETFs, you know, that was basically just a taste of what's to come. Because when the market does go south, people are going to be looking for something to put their money into. And it only take a tiny fraction of that amount to drive the prices of all the precious metals to the moon. So it's the sort of thing where that, you know, people like on the Wall Street Silver crowd who are buying this stuff hand over fist, you know, they're getting in early. And that's the best way, because once this stream becomes a flood, then I can tell you right now, the physical silver just won't be there. So there's no question about it. That's where the money's going to end up.
You know, Ed, when these tightening events, let's call it, when the Fed does this taper or raising rates or whatever it is they end up doing in the coming months, everyone's assuming we're going to have a market crash or a significant sell-off. And often gold and silver initially go down with it, right? In the rush for liquidity, the good and the bad get sold off. So is that something that you think the gold and silver market should be expecting also? You know, we have a short-term sell-off with everyone else before they launch higher? Or what's your anticipation? What are you looking for this year?
Well, we've certainly seen that in the past where the stock market tanks, is that the precious metals get hit. But that's mainly because of the fact that the big four, eight traders don't want anybody rushing from the stock market into the precious metals. And whether or not that trend continues, because the big four and eight shorts have been, you know, been sitting on the price forever. And at some point they're going to get overrun or they're going to give up. But regardless of whether there's a dip or not, not only will the stock market be tanking, but the bond market and probably the US dollar index as well. So dip or not, it should be bought. And shortly after that, because of the market structure in the futures market, you know, there's no question about it. The money's going to go in there and we're going to see a price of silver that you can't possibly imagine. I think Doug Casey described it once as trying to get the entire contents of Hoover Dam through a garden hose. That's what it's going to be like when that happens.
You know, Ed, in your column that you do each time, you always talk about the dollar index after you go over the various precious metals markets. What are you watching right now for the Dixie in relation to silver and gold prices?
Well, you know, there's two schools of thought in the dollar index. There's the people who think it's going to crash and burn, which, you know, I agree with. And there's people who say, well, because it's the cleanest dirty shirt in the fiat paper currency laundry basket, it's going to hang tough in there, but it certainly will decline over time. And there's arguments can be made for both. But the fact of the matter is that the Dixie, along with the interest rates in the bond market and the stock markets and precious metal prices, are all being actively managed right now by the Fed. There are no free markets in anything, and the dollar index is just another, you know, data point that they have to manage on a daily basis. And today, or yesterday in my column, I made the comment that, you know, once the dollar index fell down to 95.50, any and all attempts for it to break below that were turned aside. And so it was just another day where they were in that market as well. So nobody knows what the true free market value of anything is out there right now, because it's been so well managed since we went off the gold standard 50 years ago.
So do you anticipate that the dollar index could, you know, as the cleanest shirt in the hamper, that it could skyrocket, the so-called milkshake theory, go to a DXY 150, or is that, you know, more managed than that and it could never get that high? The Fed would come in and print to prevent. It seems to me DXY is within a range. Like you say, it's tightly managed. They're never going to let it go way too high or way too low. Would that agree with what you think? Or?
Yeah, certainly. They have their price targets or whatever they're doing. And I think that in some respects, they're probably making things up as they go along right now, because, you know, this financial scheme that we're living in is well past its best before use date. The other problem, if you just want to take your eye off the U.S. dollar index, is take a look at the euro. And if you're looking at a currency that's really, really, really in trouble, it's the euro. I mean, it's backed by the bonds of Portugal and Spain and Italy, all the pigs, as they called them way back when. So, you know, basically all the bonds that the European Union or the European Central Bank is issuing is backed by the faith and good credit of these pigs. Yeah. So if you're a currency guy and you want to hold a euro in one hand or a dollar, you know, which one are you going to pick? You know, I'll take the U.S. dollar any day of the week, even though I'm a hard asset kind of guy. You know, I'm also a realist, too. So, you know, where the currencies are going to go are so well, you know, it is such a managed market out there. Nothing you can't believe anything you see out there. But right now, the dollar is king. And until things change, it's going to remain king. But its days, like every other fiat currency, are numbered.
Well, I know a lot of people criticize the Canadian government these days, but you know, one thing
rightly Canada's so.
got going for it is it's a huge resource-rich energy and commodities currency. So, you know, if someone says dollar versus euro, I'm like, well, you got the wrong dollar. I think the Canadian dollar long term is going to be a stronger currency than the U.S. dollar, just from resources and energy. I mean, I don't know if you give any thoughts to that.
Well, you know, I certainly do. I mean, I was born and raised in Canada, I'm a Canadian citizen. But if you want to take a look at resource-rich countries that are in financial trouble, Canada has got a debt on it that would choke a horse, and we're going deeper into debt all the time. Mm-hmm. And our dollar is worth what? It takes $1.25 Canadian to buy a U.S. dollar. And it's the same with the Australian economy, which is a strongly resource-based economy as well. And their dollar's worth even less than ours. And if you want to really take another resource-based economy that's strong and they don't have any debt and they pay off their bills and they're one of the strongest financial balance sheets in the world, that's Russia. Mm-hmm. Russia has, you know, is the most well-managed country on the face of the earth from a financial perspective. In the central bank of the Russian Federation is a balance sheet under which anybody would be proud to have. And look at what the ruble's doing. It's way down there, 67 ruples to the American dollar. Mm-hmm. So, you know, do I want to hold a Canadian dollar? You know, I suppose it's better than holding a Russian ruble. But, you know, like they're all paper currencies. And right now, if somebody gave me a Canadian dollar and a U.S. dollar and said, which one did you keep? I'd say, I'll take the American dollar. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so what's your pick, American Silver Eagles or Canadian Maple Leafs?
I'll tell you what.
Better be the
American
Maples.
Silver Eagles. I'd take the Maples anytime, A, because of the premium. That's the big thing. You got a beautiful coin. The American Eagle is a gorgeous coin. Mm-hmm. But the premium on it is so, so huge right now because the U.S. Mint has restricted production on those things. Well, and you just can't get them for love.
Ed, here's the most beautiful coin out there, dude. It's like, forget the American Eagles, forget the Maple Leafs. This is going to be the currency of the realm in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I see it every day many times. Yeah. Yeah, so... It's amazing. As far as the Canadian one, it's also a little more pure, but it's the difference between the purity between 4/9 fine and 3/9 fine is like 1/10,000th of it. It's so insignificant. I mean, like, I was in the retail coin business for 4 years when I was living in Edmonton, and so I know a lot about the retail market. And the premium that the Canadian Mint charges over just, say, a run-unch round, like the, you know, the Wall Street Silver one you just held up, Jim, for people who have limited incomes, limited budgets, buy the cheapest generic round that they can get their hands on. That's the best way to go for them. Once you start getting into premiums for these really fancy things, and that includes the Wall Street Silver coin right there. I mean,
ours has a rocket on it, so it's better, right?
Yeah. Okay. Well, that makes it worth at least $5 more than that.
Yeah. How many coins have a rocket on them? I mean, that's just badass. Right? Yeah.
Anyway, so when you buy one of these so-called glamour coins or whatever you want to call them,
That's what they are to you? Or a glamour coin?
That's right. Oh. If you want to talk about glamour, Jim, you got to change that hat first off, right? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Well, Ed, thank you very much for joining us and giving us an update from your latest call, your latest newsletter. The audience loves to hear from you, and 2022 is shaping up to be very exciting year. I like to start so far with what the silver market's doing. And we look forward to having you on again in a few months.
Thanks for having me on, guys.